The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He restoreth my soul. Very pleasant good afternoon to everyone. Trust you can hear me until we adjust the sound system. Can't hear me. Good afternoon, everyone. I welcome you to this service of thanksgiving, service of praise and thanksgiving for Sister Elsie Payne and her son, Ivor. This is not the usual moment of a funeral because there is double grief and double sorrow. And on behalf of the officers and members of this the Ebenezer Church and the Jackson Seventh-day Adventist churches, I extend sincerest condolences to the family members, to the relatives, and those who are viewing our service online. May the God of all comfort give you strength for today and the days going forward. But then again, our Lord promised that those who mourn shall be comforted. And may we all find comfort in the service of thanksgiving today. Please remain standing for our opening hymn.
To God be the glory. Great things He has done. So love ye the world that He gave us His Son.
To God be the glory, great things He hath done. So love ye the world that He gave us His Son. His life and atonement for sin, and open the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear His voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. The Father through Jesus the Son, and give Him the glory great.
O perfect redemption,
perfect redemption, the purchase of blood to every believer. Oh, the vilest offender who truly believes that moment from Jesus a pardon receives. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, oh, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the
Jesus,
and give him the glory.
Great things he has taught us.
Great things he has taught us. Great things he has done, and great our rejoicing through Jesus. But purer and higher,
and
greater will be our wonder, our transport when Jesus we see. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. And give him the glory.
Amen. Please remain standing.
Good afternoon, everyone. First, we want to welcome Member of Parliament for St. Thomas, the Honorable Cynthia Ford. Welcome. And any other dignitaries that are here, we want to welcome you as well. And on behalf of the Benchmore House of the Venice Church, we extend our deepest condolences to the Payne family going through this moment of bereavement. We also want you guys to pray for them, say a word of encouragement during the coming time, moments, years, a shake hand, a squeeze on the shoulder, to comfort them during this difficult time. So on behalf of all the Seventh-day Adventist churches, we want to welcome you to this service of Thanksgiving on behalf of the Payne family. Thank you.
Please be seated. This time we'll have our first scripture reading, and then we'll have the prayer of comfort by Pastor Graves.
Good evening. Our scripture reading is taken from St. John chapter 14. Verses 1 to 6. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye be also. And whither I go, you know, and the way you know. Thomas saith unto him, Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way? Jesus said unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Here endeth the scripture reading. The Lord has his riches on his word.
Let's all reverently stand for the prayer of comfort. Let's all stand with bowed heads. or heads bowed, all eyes closed. Our Father and our God, we give thee thanks for the life of Sister Payne and her son Ivor. This is not a normal setting, but in life we can expect changes. We are thankful, Lord Jesus, for how mom and son had that rapport. And we are very grateful for the leadership of Sister Payne at the Jackson Church. We are thankful for her legacy, how she has impacted the congregation and the wider community. And Lord Jesus, we are thankful for her Christian spirit, her kindness, her graciousness. And indeed, she will be missed. We are also thankful for her son, Ivor, a great man, an outstanding young man, one who knew thee and one who had that faith in thee. May you comfort this family of the Paynes and the Clarks and all the extended family. Death is really an enemy, and we never get accustomed to death. But may you embrace this family of the Paynes with your love and your kindness, your understanding. May you surround the family with your love and your mercy. Comfort Ivor's wife and family and the children. And comfort all the in-laws. And may they understand that life is uncertain. What is certain in life is death. And as one theologian says, death and taxation. But may we, above all else, may we claim thee, and may the family claim thee as Savior and Lord of their lives. Life is uncertain. We never know what will happen next, but thank God we know who holds tomorrow. And may this family confide in thee. Put not their trust in man, but may they put their trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. And may they live every day as if it were the last. And Lord Jesus, those of us who witness this sermon today, may we take also an inventory of our lives. And may we examine our lives well and to comply with the model example, the example of Prince Emmanuel Jesus Christ. So Lord Jesus, as we continue this service today, for those who have not yet claimed thee as Savior and Lord, may something be said even today that will ignite their love for thee and an understanding and also an appreciation that they can take a stand for Christ Jesus. So into your hands we commit this service. Comfort all who mourn. And we are also thankful for the blessed hope. The blessed hope that is the return of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. That blessed hope will bring an end to all death, misery, and suffering. Into your hands we commit this service and guide in all the presentations and all the affairs. And at the end, may your name be glorified and may we appreciate the lives of Sister Payne and Brother Ivor. May we appreciate them greatly. And we thank you today for hearing our prayer. Thank you, Lord, for victories won. And thank you, Lord, for the forgiveness of sins. Bless all of us, we pray, in Jesus' precious name. Let everybody say, amen. Can you be seated?
Now we'll have special song by Terry Small. We shall also have a tribute. And please bear in mind that we are leaving here by 2:30, if not before. And so with the exception of the eulogy, I'm asking all those who are making a contribution to make it brief so that they can share a message of hope from the Word of God. So just do your part. Do it well. And by 2:30, if not before, we shall leave this place. God bless you.
Of a city co-glory, so bright and so fair. When I entered the gates, I cry, holy. The angels all met me there. They carry me from mansion to mansion. Lord, then I said, I want to see Jesus, the one who died for all. I bowed on my knees and cried, as I enter the gates of that city, my loved ones, they all knew me well. They took me down the streets heaven. All the sins were too many to tell. I saw Abraham, Jacob, and Timothy. Oh, but I said Timothy, I want to see Jesus, 'cause he's the one who died for me. Oh,
I remember the way Gran's laugh always sounded. Delighted and childlike. Yet she could look at you wicked like you shared the joke. Her eyes would silently assess, then my Gran would tell you about yourself. Maybe tuck it away to herself and keep her thoughts for her own safekeeping. Gran always had an opinion, and when she felt like it, everyone would know about it. This meant each and every one of us knew how much she cared for us and loved us. She just wanted us to be kept safe. Super Gran loved hard, and that feeling will stay with me always. To know and be loved by her was one of the most special experiences of my life. And the memory of sitting beside her to play with the soft skin on her arms will stay with all us grands and great-grands. Uncle Ivor loved hard and loud. This wonderful man came towards you, his voice first and his hugs last. He always let you know what he thought, but also how he felt. His powerful voice would crack as he recounted a moment of your life he'd witnessed and felt so proud of, and he looked at you with powerful emotion in his eyes because he wanted the world for everyone. He had a natural gift for knowing when you needed him, and a direct line to the most powerful love and guidance we know. Uncle's gift, to me at least, was to shout loud and proud about love, his love and God's love. He made me love myself more, and whilst he wouldn't believe me, I've always loved him just as fiercely. I always will. In these two, we were all lucky to know their love, each individual and how they showed you. Everything feels so different now. They're not physically here to share with us, yet our love with them endures and grows stronger whilst we miss their presence. To our uncle, your father, husband, brother and friend, and our gran, your mother, wife, sister and friend, I know we'll see you again. I have a short poem to read. Do not stand at my grave and weep. I am not there. I do not sleep. I am a thousand winds that blow. I am the diamond glints on snow. I am the sunlight on ripened grain. I am the gentle autumn rain. When you awaken in the morning's hush, I am the swift uplifting brush of quiet birds in circled flight. I am the soft stars that shine at night. Do not stand at my grave and cry. I am not there. I did not die. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. This song is by special request, and my prayer is that it comforts us and that we are reminded that God is victorious over all and there are no battles that he cannot win.
Is moving. On behalf of the Jackson Assembly of Adventist Church, I want to extend my sympathies and the sympathies of the church to the family of our sister Payne and brother Ivor. Today we lay to rest one of the two remaining historical figures of the Jackson SDA Church. Sister Payne was one of the first batch of members baptized by Pastor O.P. Reed after an evangelistic meeting was held by the members of the King Street Church in the Jackson area. She was baptized in 1951, and that baptism formed the Jackson Church as we know it now. After her marriage, being a faithful member of the Jackson Church for that time period, she then moved to the Ephesus SDA Church. returning to the Jackson Church in the 1980s, where she then once again became a regular and committed member of our church. Sister Payne, while for the most part was ever present, her voice was seldom heard. She came to church, took part in church, scarcely said a lot. But one thing was sure, when she actually spoke, it made sense and it encouraged all of us. As a little fellow, I can remember sitting in church and hearing her talk during the lesson studies or getting up and giving a testimony in church. And we can always be sure that whatever Sister Payne says, it caused us to think. I have fond memories myself of having preached or having taught a lesson study, and afterwards Sister Payne would come and she had this habit of just grabbing my hand and shaking it and looking up at me, "Hey, Brother Patch, you did a good job." And as a youngster in church, that spoke volumes. She always gave an encouraging word. Even during the pandemic, when as elder, I was calling around our members, I happened to call Sister Payne, and I called Sister Payne to encourage Sister Payne, and Sister Payne encouraged me. And that's the person we're talking about. When our church was dedicated on the 27th of October, 2013, as one of the two remaining founding members of our church, Sister Payne was given the honor of cutting the ribbon to officially open our church. Her voice is now silent. She will surely be missed. But one thing I can assure you of is that her contribution will never be lost and it will never be belittled. We thank the family of Sister Payne for lending her to us. And now we know that she will be, when the trumpet sound, part of God's eternal kingdom. We want to let you know, family, that she may be gone, but we are still here and we are available for anything you need. Any help you need, just call and we'll be there. May God bless you.
We stand together and sing the hymn, "Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine." Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood. Oh, this is my story, oh, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior. Perfect submission. Perfect submission, perfect delight. Visions of rapture now burst on my angels descending, bring from above echoes, echoes of mercy, whispers of love. Oh, this is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song,
is in my Savior. Perfect submission. Perfect submission. All is at rest. I in my Savior am happy and watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His love, lost in His love. Oh, this is my story. Praise in my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This is my song. Praise in my Savior all the day long.
We now have the eulogy, and that will be followed by the second scripture reading.
Good evening to the church. I have been given some latitude by the chairman, but I propose to fall in line. Question: how do we distill a lifetime of memories and experiences into a brief eulogy? It is my distinct honor to be asked to eulogize my aunt, Elsie Odessa Payne, and my cousin, Ivor Arthur Mervyn Payne. Elsie Odessa Payne was born to Miriam Chase and Garfield Mason on the 31st of March, 1930. She was raised in Whitehall Village, St. Thomas, and later moved to Clapham Christchurch and then back to Whitehall Village, where she died peacefully on the 19th of May 2023. She attended Sharon Primary, and on leaving school, she assisted her father in his shop. It was in this shop that she met Mervyn Leroy Payne, who frequently visited to deliver bread. There was a connection, and courtship began, which resulted in marriage on the 25th of July, 1957. This marriage lasted 50 years until the death of Uncle Roy. The union realized 5 children: Jean, Ivor, Diana, Jerry, and Steve. These were added to Maria and Angela and formed a beautiful family under the leadership of Uncle Roy. In addition to working in her father's shop, Auntie worked as a housekeeper in the homes of Miss Skipper and Miss Stevenson. However, the best housekeeping she did was in creating a home for her husband and children. She loved them dearly, and they reciprocated in similar manner. Today is a manifestation of that. All of her children are here this afternoon. They're here with their spouses, children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren. Some of them were here in March for her 93rd birthday and are here again today for the celebration of her life. I will now invite all of her children, their grandchildren, and great-grandchildren to just stand for a brief moment, please. All of her offspring, just stand for a brief moment. Thank you very much. You may be seated. I am well qualified to speak of the love that permeated Auntie's home because I spent many a holiday in Clapham Christ Church. Now, my mother, her sister, Eileen, immigrated to the USA in 1973. Soon after my mom's departure, I had to have surgery, and Auntie Elsie opened her home to me and looked after my recuperation. I was 13 years old at the time. Evidence of her love and care continued into my adult life. When I was going to have another procedure, she advised me to have a second opinion. I was able to avoid unnecessary surgery because of her counsel. I could hear her saying, "I can't do justice to the way she said, boy." But it was like, "Boy, you better don't let him touch you." Auntie Elsie had a great sense of humor and a hearty laugh. She was a very frank person. She shot from the hip. Diana related a story of when she was in Pathfinders. There was to be a parade through Bridgetown. That morning, she skipped breakfast in order to get there on time because the leader, Michael Stewart, was very strict. Now, it was customary for parents to attend the parade to cheer on their children. Auntie went down to cheer on Diana and to see this leader, Michael Stewart, who was giving her daughter such strict orders that she could not be late for fear of punishment. Someone in the crowd pointed him out to her. Her response was, "Where?" The person said, "There. He's the one directing the parade." Auntie said, "You mean that bony man?" Mr. Stewart's mother was nearby and overheard Auntie. She went home and told him, and they had a good laugh. Auntie never knew what it was like to hold her tongue. Matthew chapter 24 was her favorite portion of scripture. She would say that she wants to live her life in such a way that she would not be deceived and that she would inherit eternal life. I believe she is present this evening. Her spirit is present this evening with the Lord. I now turn to Ivor. I'm struggling to whether to describe him as my cousin or my brother. Two sister children. I was born in 1958, the 14th of September. He was born in 59, the 10th of April. We're just about 7 months apart. Ivor Arthur Mervyn Payne was born to Mervyn Leroy Payne and Elsie Odessa Payne on the 10th of April, 1959. He was born and raised in Clapham Christ Church. He later moved to Whitehall Village, St. Thomas, where he died peacefully on the 10th of May, 2023. Ivor attended Erdison Muller School. Jean says that he was always late in getting out of the house. It was her task to carry him to school on mornings and then make her way to St. Paul's Primary. This gave her major anxiety, so she would drop him off and pelt to get to St. Paul's. After Erdiston Muddle, Ivor went on to Parkinson Memorial Secondary School, where he excelled in many areas, especially art. On leaving school, Ivor became an apprentice automotive technician under the watchful eye of Mr. Noel White. As a boy, he dismantled everything and tried to put it back together. He brought life back to dead batteries by placing them in the sun. He would use telephone wire to connect them on his mother's partition and our grandmother's as well. And just like that, there was light. No wonder he became a proud automotive technician, not a mechanic. To call him a mechanic was offensive. He believed in being clean on the job and off the job. He would always say that no one should be able to look at you and identify you as an automotive technician. Ivor gained experience by working at several established garages in Barbados and even traveled the Caribbean to work. He worked at Plantrac in Eagle Hall, Simpson Motors, Courtesy Garage, KLB Incorporated. His final job was senior automotive technician at Stowe's Car Rental. Ivor was not satisfied with on-the-job training. Therefore, he enrolled in the two-year automotive technician program at the Samuel Jackman Prescott Polytechnic. Ivor had dreams of setting up his own high-tech workshop. Therefore, he embarked on self-employment to pursue this dream. He was also a part-time instructor at the Polytechnic in auto electrics. He did this for 7 long years. Ivor was the best automotive technician that I knew. I know there are technicians in here this evening. I would want to take issue with that, but I stress that I knew. He was born to be. He was methodical, thorough, detail-oriented, and dependable. I bought a truck before I had heavy-duty license, and Ivor was the one who drove it from Courtesy Garage. I got a contract to deliver furniture, and Ivor did the deliveries until we, that's my wife and I, got our licenses. Guess who prepared us and took us in for the test? Ivor did. I remember Ivor telling me, "Michael, Denise is ready to take this test." I was doubtful, but he took her in and he told me that test did not last very long. He said she was reversing in Buckingham Hill and he thought she was going to put the truck over the bridge I think it's the Methodist Church. And she parked it there well, and the policeman said, "Let's go in." So Ivor was also a good instructor of driving. As hobbies, he loved motorsports, riding, gardening, airplanes, and swimming. He would argue that Browns Beach was the best beach in Barbados. And I would say, "No, Payne, Brandon's is." Ivor loved family. He loved his wife, Lisa, and his children, Paula, Tamara, Kevin, Nikolai, Katrina. He met Lisa when she was on holiday in Barbados. And she recalled that Ivor said that he saw this tall darky walking up the road looking good. He was persistent. Persistent, she said. He found out where she was staying and approached her. The rest is history. They were married in St. Lucia on Pigeon Island on the 10th of April, 2001. It appears it was a thing with the Payne men to marry on their birthday. Ivor's dad married his mom on his birthday, July 25th, and Ivor married Lisa on his birthday, April 10th. On a very personal note, we were two sisters' children. As I said, born 7 months apart. We were more like brothers. He was more the country boy and I the city boy, having been born in Brewster Road, Barbies Hill. So when we would meet in Whitehall Village to vacation at our grandmother's house, we would pay King Garden Ground a visit. You just had to walk across the road. But I was timid. After all, I was lost in that cane field. So I would disappear into the cane field. And when he reappeared, Ivor had some of the best cane. Ivor knew his king. Ivor loved king. On one of my visits back home, I think it was 2 years ago, Ivor took me around his house and he showed me this cane patch. And he said, "This is juicy." I have heard, in all my years, I've heard a lot about juicy, but I don't remember sucking juicy cane. So he cut this piece and he gave it to me. And he said, "Michael, take it and plant it." I am pleased to announce this evening that I planted it. I planted it. And I have been able to reap. I can think of no other plant to plant in memory of my cousin Ivor. So I have a cane patch that I watch. Now, if you are a friend of Ivor, a relative of Ivor, and you want to plant a piece of juicy in his memory, I have a few pieces in the car. See me afterward. I know they're going fast. You see this? You could almost see the sugar in it. Oops, I almost forgot this one. Lisa said they decided they should paint their bedroom in bright colors. She brought home a color called Light My Fire. And Ivor was excited and he said, "I am going to light somebody's fire when the nights come." Sounds like Ivor to me. He had a sense of humor. Ivor had great faith and he would have shared it with whom he came into contact with, even his doctors. He even bought a Bible for one of his co-workers at Stokes Car Rental. Anyway, cuz, your purpose on earth has been completed. God wanted a top-class technician to keep those chariots rolling. Therefore, he promoted you. Rest in peace. No more pain. My cousin's pain. No more pain. May God comfort Lisa and his children, Lisa's children, all of Ivor's children, his siblings, family, and friends. Ladies and gentlemen, two of our family historians are lying here. I could ask Ivor about the ancestors, and he knew them. I could ask Auntie, and she knew them. So somebody has to step up and fill the void. On behalf, it would be remiss of me if I did not take this opportunity also, before I take my seat, to thank everyone who looked after them during their illnesses. It's always dangerous to call names, but I would just mention to the others who know who they are. But Diana and Lisa, they've done a marvelous job in looking after them. I'm sure there were many others. May God bless you. Continue to pray for the family and look out for them in the days, weeks, and months ahead. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. Our scripture reading is taken from Hebrews 11, verses 4 to 6.
and will read in your hearing. By faith, Abel offered unto God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, by which he obtained witness that he was righteous, God testifying of his gifts, and by it, he being dead, yet speaketh. By faith, Enoch was translated, that he should not see death, and was not found, because God has translated him. For before his translation, he had this testimony, that he pleased God. But without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Here ends our scripture reading.
Permit me to briefly introduce those who are on the platform this afternoon, especially for the benefit of those who are viewing online. On my far right, your left, is Elder Alistair Bailey, known to many persons as Pearson Bailey, one of the elders of the Jackson Seventh-day Adventist Church. Next to him is Elder Patrick Bryant, the first elder at the Jackson Church. Next to him is Pastor Jason Peters, the Associate Youth Ministries Director of the East Caribbean Conference of Seventh-day Adventists, and also the pastor for the hearing impaired or the deaf and the Alpha Emmanuel Church here in St. Matthias, Barbados. On my left, your right, is Pastor Haldane Graves, pastor of the St. Lucie No. 1 District. And next to him is Elder Justin Allen, elder at the Welchman Hall Seventh-day Adventist Church. The one who will address us this afternoon is Pastor Dr. Carl Dial, who is the pastor of the Jackson, Ebenezer, and Breath of Life churches. He will address us just after we sing the next hymn. I am Pastor Anthony Hoyt of the King Street Seventh-day Adventist Church. On the appropriate chord, we will stand as we sing the hymn Faith is the Victory on page 5 of your brochure.
Encamped along the hills of light, where Christian soldiers rise and press the battle, earth and night shall veil the glowing skies. Against the foes in veils below, let all our strengths be hurled. Faith is the victory we know that overcomes the world. Singing, faith is the victory. Faith is the victory. Oh, what glorious victory that overcomes the world. On every hand a foe we find, drawn up in dread array. Let tents of ease be, and onward to the fray. Salvation's, salvation's helmet, with truth all girt about, the earth shall tremble 'neath our tread, and echo with our shout, singing faith. Oh, faith is the. Oh, what glorious victory that overcomes the world.
To him that overcomes the foe, white raiment shall be. Before the angels we shall know each name confessed. Then onward from the hearts with love aflame will vanquish all the host of night. In Jesus' conquering name, singing faith is the, oh, faith is the victory. Singing, oh, glorious victory that overcomes the world.
Seated. Me or the microphones, which one? Thank you, Pastor Hoyt, for your words of introduction. Good afternoon once again. I want to extend apologies on behalf of Pastor Vincent Cook. He was scheduled to be the speaker today, but Pastor Cook is down with the flu. And you know, when there's the flu, you prefer not to be in public places. So he's recuperating from the flu and he's asked me to fill in for him this afternoon. I want to welcome MP for St. Thomas, this is Ms. Cynthia Ford, and other ministers of religion who are here today. I welcome you. This is a time of much grief and sorrow, and I trust for the next few minutes I will share with you a message of hope from the Word of God. I'm reading for you from the book of John, the 14th chapter in the book of John, John chapter 14. We had it for our scripture reading. It is familiar to all of us. And before I begin, I too would want to, I'm just new, as it were, to the Jackson Church, and my prayers and support is certainly, they're certainly with the family. John chapter 14, I'm reading verses 1, 2, and 3. The Word of God says, let not your heart, you know that text? Let not your heart be troubled, right? You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are what? Many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, Jesus says, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. I have entitled the message for today, I go to prepare a place for you. Let's pray. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, for the next few moments I stand to speak a message of hope. A message of encouragement to help us to understand that in these moments, to remind us that death does not have the last word. So I pray, God, that you will come by Holy Spirit, speak to me, speak through me, and bless us as we celebrate the life of your children today. In Jesus' name, amen. I believe it was A.P. Carter, I am told, A.P. Carter wrote the lyrics of what is now an epic hymn. And Albert Brumley, the famous Albert Brumley, arranged the music. And in somewhere in January 1962, Jim Reeves released this most popular song. You know the song. It says, "This world is not my home. I'm just passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue." And he concludes, "And I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven is not my home, Lord, what will I do?" Incidentally, before you go any further, this is my brother, it's with the cane. Yeah, I'm the pastor of the church, so I have to get my slice of cane first. "If heaven is not my home, then Lord, what shall I do?" There is a text. Certainly you will agree with me that this world is not our home. There's too much mess in this world, wouldn't you agree? Yes, there's so much crime and war and bloodshed and global warming and the lights of it. And Job said in Job chapter 1, Job said, "Naked came I out of my mother's womb, and naked shall I return. The Lord gave, and the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord." Jesus affirmed in the book of Luke chapter 12 and verse 5, Jesus says, "Take heed and beware of covetousness, for a man's life consisteth not in the abundance of the things he possesseth." And the reason why Jesus said that is that it doesn't matter what we have, where we live, or who we are, at this point we have nothing. Are you with me so far? All right. So what we have, where we live, is not our home. Your home is not your home. If you're renting, you know it's not your home. If you have a mortgage, fail to pay the rent, the mortgage a month, you know it is not your home. And even if you think it is your home, as a homeowner, let a good hurricane pass, and you know it is not your home. This world is not my home. We're just passing through. In the book of John chapter 14, John chapter 14 incidentally is a continuation of John chapter 13. In the New Testament, in the original language, there are no chapters. They just flowed from one section into another. So in John chapter 13, Jesus told Peter in the last verse, verse 38, "The cock shall not crow till thou hast denied me thrice." That's the last verse in chapter 13. And then in chapter 14, immediately after that, Jesus said to Peter and to all of us, "Let not your heart be troubled. In my Father's house there are many mansions." Now let me go back a little. In the book of Genesis, chapters 1 and 2, God created a man and a woman and gave them a home. Are you with me? It is a place called the Garden of Eden. You know the story well. The Bible says in Genesis 2 and 15, the Lord God made man, put him in the garden, and told him to take care of it. That's your home. Well, you know the story. Satan came along, beguiled the man. They disobeyed God and gave the rulership of the earth that belonged to them, they gave it over to the devil. Jesus calls Satan in John chapter 12 and verse 31, the prince of this world. Paul calls him in Ephesians 2 and verse 2, the prince of the power of the air that is now working in the sons of disobedience. In 2 Corinthians 4 and verse 4, we read, in whom the God of this world have blinded the minds of men. Ladies and gentlemen, the world does not belong to the devil. Jesus says, the word of God says in Psalm 24, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. Would you say amen? So because of sin, we were kicked out, we were evicted. We deserve death. We deserve separation from a holy God. But in the book of Romans, Paul says in Romans 5 and verse 8, God demonstrated his love towards us. Help me somebody. In that while we were yet sinners, guess what? Christ died for us. And so, ladies and gentlemen, because of sin, God evicted man from his Edenic home. But his great love for man was so strong, he wants us to be with him in paradise. And that's why John 3:16 is so important. John 3:16 says what? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. And now anybody, whosoever believeth in him, shall not what? Perish, but have everlasting life. There are times when we have to leave home. We go on vacation. And you know, I discover, first of all, I want to tell you something. When you go on vacation and you're spending time in other people's house, don't stand long. Are you hearing me? After we, it becomes still. Let's get back to what I'm saying. You go on holiday, but I have discovered that on holiday, something happens inside. You want to go home. Isn't that true? Yeah, I'm talking to myself. Hospitalization, you're away from home. Visiting friends, you're away from home. And though your home may be a humble home or a lavish home, no matter where we roam, there is no place like home. The Bible tells us that Jacob fled from home. The prodigal son left home. Israel were kicked out of their home. So where we lived on this earth is not our home. We're just passing through. And Jesus said, in my Father's house, there what? Yeah, man, there are many mansions. And here, Jesus, I have gone to prepare a, I know it is not your home. Earth is not our home. I have gone to prepare a place for you. And can I tell you something? Heaven is a real place.
Yes, sir.
Huh? Come on, help me, somebody. Heaven is a real place. It is not a retirement home for the dead. It is a real place. Hello, I'm going to show it to you in a minute. And it's a prepared place for a prepared people. Incidentally, Jesus himself said in Matthew chapter 7, verse 21, Jesus says, not everyone that says, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father, which is in heaven. Peter says, it is an inheritance, incorruptible, undefiled, faileth not away. It is reserved in heaven for you. And then John said, I saw it. Revelation chapter 21. Let me read it quickly for you. Revelation chapter 21. Peter, John says, and I, John, saw a new kind of heaven and a new earth. You know why? Because the first heaven and the first earth were what? Passed away. And there was no more sea. So, if you're going on a cruise, go now. No more sea. Are you following? Good. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven. And the man could not contain himself. He said it was like a bride adorned for her husband. You know, when you go to a wedding, you know, people don't look at the men. Yeah. Man, you didn't know that? People go to a wedding not look at you. They want to see who? Man, yeah, they want. And as a matter of fact, when the song starts, here comes the bride, you just sitting down there all, you were sitting, I gotta speak English, you were sitting there all the time, nobody pay you no mind, but as soon as the bride comes, everybody stands up and looks at the bride. Are you hearing me, church? John could not describe this thing, man. He says, it's like a bride adorned for her husband. And then he said, I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men. And God shall be with them, and he will dwell with them, and there shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. Come on, somebody ought to say amen. Since, and let me do somebody home that God has gone to prepare for us. We're concluding. No more sickness. Are you hearing me? No more pain. No more sorrow. I heard David Phelps got this song saying, no more nights, no more pain. No more tears, never crying again. And praises to the great I am. We will live in the light of the risen Lamb. So no more nights. And Jesus promised those who turned their lives to him, he says, I will come again, and I'm going to receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. You know why I like that text? The text says that somebody going to heaven, and it might as well be me. Are you hearing me, church? I go to prepare a place for you, man. And if I go, Jesus says, I'm going to come again. He came the first time. We call it Christmas. And if he came the first time, he will come again the second time. I will come again, and I'm going to receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. So, the curse of sin will be over. I believe with all my heart, because of the life that Brother Ivor and Sister Elsie live, I believe that when Jesus comes again, they will be among the resurrected to see Jesus when he comes the second time. Paul says, my last text, for the Lord himself. Oh, listen, if you don't get excited about serving the Lord, are you hearing me, church?
Yes, sir.
Can I tell you something? Serving the Lord is the best thing that anybody can do. Are you hearing me, church?
Yes.
Listen, I heard it was Albert, what's his name now? Albert Camus, who said, I would rather live believing there's a God and die and find out there is no God than to live believing there is no God and die and find out that there's a God. The sweetest thing any person can do is to commit their lives to the Lord Jesus Christ. For the Lord himself, man, shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trumpet of God, and the dead, come on, help me somebody, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. And you know what shall in Bajan parlance means? It bound to must happen. Huh? The dead in Christ shall rise. It shall happen. It's no myth. It's no fake news. Are you listening to me, church? Jesus is coming again, and all those who have fallen asleep in Christ shall live once more. Would you say amen?
Amen.
What a day that will be. The redeemed will be reunited with their departed loved ones who also love and serve the Lord Jesus Christ. And there is a song that says, what? Never part again? The answer ricochets through the corridors of time. No! Never part again. And soon we shall with Jesus reign and never, never part again. Oh, ladies and gentlemen, as I concluded, death will be swallowed up in victory. Death will have no more sting. Grave will have no more victory. Sister Payne will be there. Brother Payne will be there. By the grace of God, I pledge I will be there when the roll is called up yonder. When you hear Jesus says, come ye blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundations of the world. Will you be there? I invite you to be there. Let's go to our Father's house. I invite you to be there when the saints go marching in. I invite you to be there when the roll is called up yonder. And if it's your desire to be there, come on, stand with me for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you again, Lord, for lending to us your two children. They have now laid down the burdens of this life, and they await the voice of the life giver. I pray, God, that you will send your Holy Spirit now to put your loving arms around each member of this family. Help them to know, Lord, these families. Help them to know, Lord, that they can see their loved ones again because of the promise of your word. You have gone to prepare a place for us. And you're not sending anyone. You yourself will come to receive us unto yourself. Oh God, I pray for those of us who are alive and remain. May we so live. Help us to understand that the things of the world are temporary. What you have in store for us are for eternity. So help us to make important decisions so that when you burst the clouds and come again as you said you would, May all of us be found ready to be reunited with Brother Ivor and Sister Elsie, never to part again. This is my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Please remain standing for our closing.
Let us pray again. Our Father and our God, we thank you so much for the fact that despite being the creator, you didn't create death. However, God, you have the answer for it. And as we come this evening to lay your faithful servants to their final resting place on this earth, we know that you are the one who will make all the difference. You will wrap your arms around those who mourn. And you will be a source of inspiration and encouragement to those who miss them. But you should also be the hope of those who wait until you come, until you burst the other skies and put in your appearance with your train of angels. We pray that we all will be faithful so that one, that on that great getting up day, when Ivor and Elsie rise, all of us will indeed rise to go with you in the sky. Until then, Lord, we pray you bless us and keep us. Make your face to shine upon us and be gracious unto us. You lift up the light of your countenance even in the shadow of death, and give us peace. In Jesus' name, amen.
Page number 6. Would you be free from your burden of sin? There is power in the blood.
Would you be free from your burden of sin? There is power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you our evil victory win? There is wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be free from your passion and pride? Oh, come for a cleansing to Calvary's tide. Oh, there is power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, there's wonder-working power in the precious. Would you do service? Would you do service for Jesus? There is power in the blood. Oh, would you live daily His praises to sing? There is power in the blood. Oh, there is power, power, there's wonder working power in the blood. There is power, would you be free from your burden of sin? Would you be free from your burden of sin? Oh, there's power in the blood, would you a river of victory win? Oh, there is power, power, there's wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, there's wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb.
I want to welcome you to the second phase of this service of Thanksgiving. And as we are about to begin, I'm reading for you from the book of Corinthians, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, reading from verse 51 to 58. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Shall we pray? Gracious Heavenly Father, we are assembled at this spot to tenderly commit the body of your daughter to the earth. Lord, we do so with the assurance of the promises of your word. You promise that you will come again. And your word reminds us that when the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, the dead in Christ shall rise first. I pray, Heavenly Father, that holy angels who accompany your daughter through the many years of her life will mark this spot. And on that grand resurrection morning, because of her commitment to you, her love for you, and her willingness to serve you, we believe, Lord, that she will be among the redeemed, coming from the earth, alive in Jesus, who is the resurrection and the life, this time to live forever and ever. Once again, O God, comfort the family, strengthen them, and help that they too would so live, that on that grand resurrection reunion morning, they and all of us will be reunited, never to part again. Bless this aspect of our service. In Jesus' name, amen. For as much as God in his infinite wisdom and mercy have permitted our dear sister Elsie Odessa Payne to fall asleep in Christ, we do tenderly commit her body to the ground. Earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, in the sure and certain hope of a joyful resurrection when our Lord shall return in glory, when this body of our humiliation shall be changed and made like unto your glorious body. Amen. There's a land that is fairer than day, and by faith we can see it afar, for the Father waits over the way to prepare us a dwelling place there, in the sweet by and by. But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that you sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Just over the mountain in the promised land lies the holy city built by God's own hand.
Just over the mountain in the promised land lies the holy city built by God's own hand. As our weary footsteps gain the mountain's crest, we can view our homeland and eternal rest. We are nearing home. We are nearing home. See the splendor gleaming from the domes afar. See the glory streaming through the gates ajar. There we soon will enter, nevermore to roam. Hear the angels singing, we are nearing home, we are nearing home. In the roles of the prophets we have long been told, of the wondrous city with its streets of gold. Now with raptured visions we can see it there, with its walls of jasper and its mansions fair.
We are nearing home.
We are nearing home. We are nearing home. See the splendor gleaming from the domes afar. See the glory streaming through the gates ajar. There we soon will enter, nevermore to roam. See the angels singing, we are nearing home, we are nearing home. Those who enter the city are the faithful few, who keep God's commandments, faith of Jesus too. They will lift our voices through the endless days, in sweet songs of gladness and in songs of praise. We are nearing home. We are nearing home. See the splendor gleaming from the domes afar. See the glory streaming through the gates ajar. There we soon will enter, nevermore to roam. See the angels singing, we are nearing home, we are nearing home. My brother, my sister, will you meet us there? In that land of sunshine where there'll be no care. Accept all God's message and to him be true. Then when Jesus cometh, he will call for you.
We are nearing home.
We are nearing home. We are nearing home. See the splendor gleaming from the domes afar. See the glory streaming through the gates ajar. There we soon will enter, nevermore to roam. Hear the angels singing, we are nearing home. We are nearing home.
And I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and there shall be his people. And God himself shall be with them and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. There shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying. Neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. And he that sat upon the throne said, Behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, Write, for these words are true and faithful. And he said unto me, It is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, and I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of the water of life freely. He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my sons. The golden morning is fast approaching. Jesus soon will come to take his faithful and happy children to their promised home. Man that is born of a woman is of few days and full of trouble. He cometh forth like a flower and is cut down. He fleeth also as a shadow and continueth not. Seeing his days are determined, the number of his months are with thee. Thou hast appointed his bounds that he cannot pass. But man dieth and wasteth away. Yea, man giveth up the ghost. And where is he? As the waters fail from the sea and the flood decayeth and drieth up, so man lieth down and rise not until the heavens be no more. They shall not awake nor be raised out of their sleep. If a man die, shall he live again? All the days of my appointed time will I wait till my change come. Thou shalt call, and I will answer thee. How sweet are the tidings that greet the pilgrim's ear as he wanders in exile from home. Soon, soon will the Savior in glory appear, and soon will the kingdom come. Final hymn, and can it be? We'll pause the hymn for the laying of the wreaths, and at the end we shall sing this final song, Amazing Love, How Can It Be, that Thou, My God, Didst Die For Me. we shall now sing the hymn, And Can It Be? Sure, the family, the Payne family, would want me to extend to you their appreciation and their thanks for your praise and for your support and for your presence at the church service and here this afternoon. And so on their behalf, we want to say thank you for coming by to express your words of condolences to them. We shall conclude this service with the prayer. I'm going to ask the first elder of the Jackson Church to come forward and say that final prayer, and then I shall give the benediction. Elder Brian.
Thank you. Let's all bow our heads, please. We are grateful, Father, for your goodness towards us, for bringing us safely here. We thank you, Father, for the fact that Sister Elsie has been walking with you for all these years. We do not have to tell you to mark the spot because we know you know exactly where she is. And on that great getting up morning, we know that when you call, she will rise to be with you in glory. We ask, Father, now that you would continue to wrap your arms around the family. We know death has been described as man's worst enemy. But we understand from your word that this is temporary and that one day she will rise to be with you in glory. We pray, Father, that all those of our family members who are here this evening, who would sorrow now, would recognize that one day there will be joy when the work is done, when you gather all your people to be with you forever. Help, Father, that you, through the aid of your Holy Spirit, will continue to attend them. Continue to succor them, continue to keep them ever under your almighty arms. And may they too be determined in their own minds that when you should come, they would also be with Sister Elsie once again, where they would be able to live throughout the ceaseless ages of eternity. Thank you for all you will continue to do for us and for them is my prayer, for Christ's sake. Amen.
Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you peace now and forevermore. Amen. Amen.